Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the closing ceremony for the Fund for American Studies 2016 Summer Programs. I'm Joe Starrs, Director of U.S. Programs and the Institute on Political Journalism, or IPJ. Go IPJ. Today's ceremony marks both a beginning and an end. We end the summer after 8 weeks of living, learning, and interning here in our nation's capital. Today is also a beginning for our students, who will soon be counted among the 15,000 plus alumni scattered around the world. The beginning of what we hope will be a lifelong relationship as the newest members of the TFAS family. To quote from the smash Broadway hit Hamilton, "You arrived here young, scrappy, and hungry. You leave us a little wiser, a little more polished, and yet still hungry and hopeful for what the future can hold. As far as I know, none of you have thrown away your shot." Our mission at TFAS is bold but simple: to change the world by developing leaders for a free society. We are confident that because of the class of 2016, the world will be a better place, and that when the time comes, the students in this room will step forward into the arena, of life to be honorable and bold leaders that the world so sorely needs. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank you, our students, for choosing to spend your summer with us. I'd like to thank the family and the friends of our students who are here today, mom and dad, grandparents, brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles. Thank you for coming to join us. I'd like to thank our faculty who are here and all our faculty who are not able to be here for giving of themselves in the classroom. We're also grateful to our internship sponsors who opened the doors so our students could gain invaluable experience. I want to thank our mentors who volunteered their time so our students could have one-on-one mentoring, advice, and help. To the benefactors and the supporters of TFAS, thank you for making this summer possible. Without your generosity, without your support, we simply would not be able to do what we do. I'd like to welcome and thank the members of the Board of Visitors, the Board of Trustees who are here, and the Board of Regents. This summer, we are privileged to partner with the Reagan Foundation and offer a new program for our students, Leadership and the American Presidency, LTAP for short. I want to offer particular thanks to the Reagan Foundation staff here in DC, to Janet Tran, Meredith Staza, Brianna Gessler. Thank you guys for working with us. We're so appreciative of all that you did to make this inaugural class a success. We're grateful and honored to be your partners. I wanted to thank my colleagues here at TFAS for your hard work and your dedication. I want to name some of them individually, so please hold your applause to the end. First, I want to thank Mally Woodfin in our Recruitment and Admissions Office. Mally took on additional responsibilities this summer, and we're very, very grateful. Carly Chafee, who headed up IPVS for the first time, did a great job. Joel Troutman, head of IBGA. Colin Parks, director of IEIA, the Institute on Economic and International Affairs. And Matt Pfister, who ran our oldest program this summer. Also, a big shout out to our program advisors, Bettina Canuto, Emma Palefko, Rachel Sullivan, Kate Koleski, and Rachel Meltzer. I also want to thank our Vice President of the U.S. Programs, Shane Mazzella, and our Senior Vice President, Steve Slattery, TFAS President, Roger Rehm, my colleagues, Jane Mack, Carrie DiNarda, Kristen Underwood, and many other of our colleagues. I also want to offer a special thank you to my colleague, Dana Fott. This summer, Dana took on additional duties to help manage the day-to-day operations of the Summer Operations Program. And Dana, I think I speak for all of my colleagues at TFAS, especially in 1621. We could not have done it without you, Dana, so thank you. Let's give a round of applause to Dana and the rest of the TFAS family. Next, I'd like to introduce two of our students who will be leading us in an invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance. Emily Richard, a recent graduate from the United States Air Force Academy, will be leading us in the pledge. Emily is from Katy, Texas. She was part of IEIA this summer and interned at the Foreign Policy Initiative. Leading us in our invocation will be Michael B. Lee. Michael is a graduate of Hillsdale College and hails from Raleigh, North Carolina. This summer, he was part of IBGA, the Institute on Business and Government Affairs, and interned at the Holt Group. Please stand.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we look around this room today, we see many around us that have sparked something new in us this summer. Friends, family members, mentors, donors, supervisors, professors, and organizers all played a role in shaping our experience this summer. Lord, we are so grateful that these individuals who saw something in us that they believed to be worthwhile investment. We have learned so much from their unique lessons. May you bless them endlessly every day. Lord, we thank you for so often we forget to do so. So often we receive blessings, success, and achievement and forget that you played a role. This summer, we have been instilled with the gifts of ambition, skill, and wisdom. But we know that these seeds that have been planted cannot flourish unless you will it. So Lord, we ask you for those gifts now. Give us ambition, Lord, that we may have vision for our futures and a constant dissatisfaction with things that are average, effortless, or unrewarding. May this ambition be rooted in servant leadership. Give us honed and expert skills, Lord, that when we achieve our goals and match our visions, we may be able to not only perform, but thrive in our professional environments, setting examples of hard work and expertise for those around us. And give us wisdom, Lord, that as we thrive through our careers, we may be ever contemplative individuals, never turning down an opportunity to learn and always welcoming conversation. Remembering that wisdom is the true mark of an individual's success. Help us also, Lord, to not get bogged down by the seriousness of our careers and ambitions, to not let selfishness cloud our social journey, and be ever aware that love for one of your children is love for you. Your gift of human connection is the most valuable and unique gift you have granted to any of your creatures. Give us the humility and charity to not only utilize it, but prioritize it. Let us remember that when we say with one voice that we are one nation under God, that we are reminding ourselves that there will always be something over us, watching, guiding, and listening. Bless us, Lord. Bless the Fund for American Studies, and bless this great country of ours. In your name we pray. Amen.
So it's our tradition for this part of the program, to invite students up, each student representing one of our institutes. And as I mentioned earlier, our students come here to live, learn, and intern. Within that, a lot is involved. And so we've broken it out into different sections. And so today, discussing what it's like to live here in Washington, D.C., and representing IPJ, the Institute on Political Journalism, is Megan Maxey. Megan attends school at California State University in Fullerton. Her hometown is Galt, California, and this summer her internship was with Town Hall Media. Let's welcome Megan Maxey.
Thank you, Joe. And good morning, everyone. I'm so honored to be speaking to you today. Living here in Washington, D.C. has definitely been a life-changing experience. A year ago, I would have never imagined spending my summer 5 minutes from the Lincoln Memorial and around a corner from the White House. Looking back to what seems like forever ago on move-in day, I had no idea how truly impactful this summer would be on me. The opportunities provided by TFAS and my internship have given me a solid foundation for a successful career in journalism. This summer changed my life, not only because of the work experience and learning opportunities, but because of the people I've met and bonded with. While living on the sixth floor of Potomac, I have made friendships and memories that will last a lifetime. My floor bonded pretty quickly, as we were all motivated to make the most of our summers. And over the past 2 months, I have become a part of an environment of inspiration. These peers I've made are from all over the country, but they share one similar trait. They aren't afraid to go after what they want. Living with outgoing, ambitious, and like-minded people has made these experiences here even more special. Some highlights include dancing to the Army Band's music in front of the Washington Monument on a rainy 4th of July, rooting for our team at the Congressional Baseball Game, and walking to the National Mall anytime we liked because it was only 5 minutes away. Not everyone has seen our nation's capital like we have. Don't get me wrong, being an intern with TFAS and living in Foggy Bottom is not a vacation. It's hard work, and it's an opportunity to change your life. Because we haven't just been playing this summer. We've been making vital connections. How many times did you guys hear networking this summer? Probably more than you can count. Because TFAS offers incredible networking opportunities. We don't just meet the people we live with or the people we intern with. We meet our mentors, our friends' mentors, our coworkers' former boss, our roommates' connections, and the list goes on and on. Because the possibilities of meeting the right person who will help you in the future are endless here. While living here, we have had the opportunity to meet the people who are currently working in this city, possibly in positions that we might want to have someday. Thanks to TFAS, we not only experience DC in a memorable way, but we are able to meet and connect with the people who make up this city. And we also live right next to the people who will succeed here in the future. As we become alumni of TFAS, we must not take these connections for granted. In the years to come, that kid I always said hello to on the elevator, or my friend from across the hall, or the girls I went to the museum with that one time, may become key factors in my success in the future. We all owe a thank you to TFAS and the entire team who made this experience so life-changing. Whether it be the new work experience at our internships, the business connections we've landed through TFAS events, or the memories we've made with our new friends, every single one of us walks away today impacted. Thank you.
Next, we'd like to invite two students forward to discuss the Learn component of our program. Of course, this takes place primarily in the classroom and with our partners, George Mason University. So I want to thank our partners at George Mason for helping us to offer world-class courses for our students. I want to thank Mark Funstein, who's here with us today, who's the TFAS liaison for George Mason University. But this learning takes place not just in the classroom, but in our site visits, our briefings, our seminars, our small group events, tours on the Hill, the State Department. Everywhere you go, TFAS students are learning. To tell a little more about it, we have Jordan Lopez representing IEIA, the Institute on Economic and International Affairs. Jordan attends school at DePaul University. His hometown is Chicago, Illinois, and this summer he interned with the Rumsfeld Foundation. Also joining us will be Daniel Bodie, who represents ICPES, our oldest institute, the Institute on Comparative and Political Economic Systems. Dan is from Flowery Branch, Florida, and interned with Child Care Aware. Let's welcome both those students now.
Thank you, Mr. Starrs, and thank you, Megan, for your thoughtful words. Good morning, everyone. And as mentioned, my name is Jordan Lopez, and I am here to speak to you today about the second pillar of our program this summer, Learn. After serving in the Army, I came home with the belief that the learning experiences and bonds I was exposed to would be the strongest I ever participated in. This program has proven to me that I need to add to that list. This summer, I have taken two classes, International Economic Policy and U.S. Foreign Policy. Each of these classes has been among the most exciting, challenging, and engaging courses I have taken in my academic career. Both professors Bradley and Armstrong are two of the most intelligent and humble people I have ever met. They have a wealth of experience and knowledge, but treat each person with consideration and respect. My favorite part of Professor Bradley's class would have to be her human connection to economics. Her idea that economics is more than numbers, it's about people. Specifically with our guest lecture from Dr. Joseph Connors of Florida Southern College on why economic freedom matters. For Professor Armstrong, it would also be his last lecture. Members of our class were tasked with debating three grand strategies of foreign policy: liberal institutionalism, neo-isolationism, and primacy. Each group did a fantastic job presenting their argument while staying professional and courteous. I believe this gives some insight into Professor Armstrong's goal for our class and his method of instruction. He gave us information on each strategy, presented both sides of the argument, and finally allowed us to make an informed decision as a class. In the end, I truly believe we were one step closer to his goal for us to find truth. If I were only able to participate in my internship and classwork, it would still be an incredible summer. But the special events provided by TFAS have been the proverbial icing on the cake. I had the opportunity to attend four small groups, including a White House briefing with Ryan Ramsey, Director of Confirmations, and an Office of Regional Security briefing from Dan Holtrup, a U.S. Foreign Service officer at the State Department. I participated in a tour and briefing at the Japanese Embassy, multiple guest lectures from professionals like Trevor Thrall of the Cato Institute, Art Laffer, the economist known for the Laffer Curve, and Dr. Macubin Owens from the Institute of World Politics. Two alumni events, including the round table session, where I had the pleasure of meeting Heather Robinson, a special inspector general for Afghanistan Reconstruction, who has now become a personal mentor of mine. These events could be a program unto themselves. They not only expose you to some of the most experienced and renowned experts in DC, but do it in a way that is informative and personalized. Each of the small group sessions allowed us to stay in contact with the speaker beyond their presentation. I was especially impacted by the small group with Dan Holtrup because of our mutual military experience and my interest in the transition into public service. His advice on the progression from the military to civilian sectors was profoundly educational. I look forward to staying in contact with him. I think the most important thing I learned from the events is the genuine willingness of those who volunteer their time to help us become stronger professionals, but also better people. Overall, I am incredibly lucky to have participated in these opportunities to learn and will never forget these experiences. I would like to give a special thanks to Colin Parks, Kate Kilseski, and all of the TFAS staff for their dedication and hard work. Thank you.
Good morning, guys. Wasn't Jordan great? My name is Daniel Bowding, and I am a history, political science, and economics triple major on the pre-law track at Berry College. I'm exhilarated to say that I spent the last 8 weeks with the Englischef Institute of Comparative Political and Economic Systems, TFAS's oldest and most profound institute. This summer in D.C., I have had them has been better than I could ever imagine. I think, however, it is important to establish the context of how special this program has been to me. You see, I wasn't supposed to go to college, much less be in D.C. I started my high school career homeless, and I've been on my own since I was 16. I want to thank the generous financial support TFAS has provided me, and specifically Mr. Bernard Marcus and the Marcus Foundation for making it possible for me to be here today. It would not have been possible for me to imagine that by the end of this program, I would have sat in the boardroom of the Board of Governors at the Federal Reserve, visited Mount Vernon, worked at the Capitol a few times a week, and walked by the White House every single morning. This summer, I met Senator Elizabeth Warren, Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, Speaker of the House Paul Ryan, and Senator Rand Paul, and so many others. One of my favorite experiences this summer was one day when I attended a delightful bipartisan hearing at the Capitol by Senators Tim Scott and Cory Booker. I then went to AEI to listen to Paul Ryan present his poverty plan. Now this is the kicker. Immediately after this meeting, I rushed back to the Capitol because Georgia's greatest son, Congressman John Lewis, a prominent leader in the civil rights movement, led another sit-in, although this time in a slightly different venue. 2 weeks later, I had the profound opportunity to join many other TFAS students at the same location, the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives. This summer, I had the opportunity to speak with Libertarian presidential candidate Gary Johnson at the National Press Club and watch Donald Trump walk out of the Capitol Hill Club soon after an embarrassing meeting with Republican leadership in which he attempted to cite the 1st, 2nd, and 12th article of the Constitution. This summer, I spent most of my evenings studying at the steps of the Capitol and preparing for the LSAT beside the statues of law and justice at the Supreme Court. Now, isn't that something? You know, Georgia boys like me don't get chances like that very often. I also had the chance to develop new friendships with many of the young people whom I believe will be leading the work of the free world in the years to come. And specifically to you spectacular achievers, I would like to conclude by leaving this short passage. I know of no more encouraging fact than the unquestionable ability of man to elevate his life by conscious endeavor. It is something to be able to paint a particular picture or to carve a statue, and so to make a few objects beautiful. But it is far more glorious to carve and paint the very atmosphere and medium through which we look, to affect the quality of the day. That is the highest art. I am truly honored to have been able to spend my summer connecting with, and more importantly, learning from some of the most absolutely brilliant people in Washington, D.C. This summer has been the most rewarding and humbling experience of my life, and I look forward to what the future holds. Thank you.
Next, we want to talk about the main reason most of our students come here, and that's to intern. Our internships take place all over the Washington, D.C. metro area. We place interns on Capitol Hill, federal agencies, the journalism field, radio, TV, magazines, newspapers, in the lobbying field, in the nonprofit field, every component that you can think of, every type of business, everything, anything that has anything to do with Washington, we place students in internships there. Now, here to talk about their internships are two students. First, we have Blake Broadneck, representing IBGA, the Institute on Business and Government Affairs. Blake attends school at Loyola University in Chicago. His hometown is Madison, Wisconsin, and this summer he interned with the International Paper. Also coming forward will be Talise Massasoy, representing LTAP, Leadership in the American Presidency, the program I mentioned brought to us in partnership with the Reagan Foundation. Talise attends school at Vanderbilt University, and this summer, her hometown is Springfield, Missouri, and her internship this summer was in the Washington office for the Navajo Nation. Let's welcome both students.
My name is Blake Broadneck, and I participated in the Institute of Business and Government Affairs here at TFAS and interned in the Global Government Relations Department at International Paper this summer. Coming into the summer, I didn't know anything about International Paper. However, I knew it was the perfect place for me within a few minutes of talking to my future supervisor. This was because since International Paper is such a big company, they're able to place me where my abilities were best suited. I didn't know this coming in, but International Paper is actually a Fortune 100 company and is the third largest exporter within the United States. Therefore, even though my supervisor mostly works on supply chain issues, they were able to be flexible, so many of the projects I worked on were with the International Trade Department. About a month ago, my supervisor noticed my passion for economic development, and she asked me to give them a presentation on the emerging markets in sub-Saharan Africa. I gave the presentation last week, and it was honestly one of the most exhilarating hours of my life. It was informative for all of us. For my company, they got to learn about the growing consumer class in Nigeria, and about how Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania are now the second, third, and fourth fastest growing economies in the world for growth projections up to 2024. And for me, I got to learn that giving a presentation in front of Fortune 100 executives is a lot different than giving a presentation in front of my Intro to International Politics class. I really do give credit to International Paper for placing me in circles where I could network and advance in my career. For example, about 2 weeks ago, they invited me to their table at the International Trade Prom at the Ronald Reagan International Trade Center. I had recognized a few faces due to some of the meetings I had been at during the summer. However, the person to my left, I had never met before. Long story short, he worked at one of the major consulting firms, and he was over his company's Africa and Middle East divisions. We had a long conversation at dinner that night, ranging from countries diversifying from oil to smart cities to return migration. By the end of the conversation, he had invited me to his office to discuss internship opportunities. I walked into his office thinking he made an internship in their DC office because I just decided to transfer to George Washington University next fall for my sophomore year. We sat down and he said, unfortunately, we like our interns to be here during the day, so we usually only hire grad school interns. However, I was impressed with your passion for Africa and the Middle East, so here's what I'll do for you. I know you're starting Arabic next year, and we need more Arabic speakers. And a lot of the companies that we consult have their Middle East headquarters in Dubai. So how about I send your resume and CV along with a recommendation from myself, and we can go get you an internship in Dubai. These are the type of... These are the type of networking opportunities that International Paper put me in. On June 4th, I came into TFAS as an 18-year-old kid who had never had a job or an internship. Now today, I get to leave TFAS with an internship set up here in DC next semester, an internship in Accra, Ghana next winter break, an internship in investment banking next summer in New York City, and then hopefully we can make Dubai work in the future. Now, I'm not going to lie, I don't know exactly what the future holds for me. I still have 3 years left of undergrad, so I definitely have time to figure that out. However, I will always remember TFAS and International Paper as a launching pad for whatever I find myself doing in the future. Thank you.
Yate. That's greetings in Navajo. It's a phrase I picked up this summer while being thrown into meetings and negotiations with tribal leaders. For the last 2 months, I've been working at the Navajo Nation Washington office, an entity I didn't even know existed before my interview with the executive director. It may come as a surprise to you, as it did to my coworkers, that I'm not Navajo. I've never been on a reservation, and most of what I know about Native communities before my internship came from movie depictions and Thanksgiving propaganda. Needless to say, I was nervous about working with the Navajo Nation. I feared I would sound culturally incompetent or not be passionate enough about the issues to make a real impact. But I think President Ronald Reagan aptly described the biggest lesson I've learned this summer when he said, "There are no constraints on the human mind, no walls around the human spirit, no barriers to our progress except those we ourselves erect." I gathered early on that I could be the biggest propellant or the biggest deterrent for a great professional experience. It's a constant decision to ask questions, to admit my ignorance, and to look for areas with which I identify. But actively engaging in those ways has afforded me so many opportunities. As a little background, the Navajos are the largest tribe in the United States, and their ancestral homeland, or reservation, which is about the size of West Virginia, covers a large section of northeastern Arizona and portions of Utah and New Mexico. The Navajo Nation Washington office acts as an extension of the Navajo government, advocating for the tribe to Congress, federal agencies, and the White House. They represent a region with 42% unemployment, a median household income of just $20,000, and a 7% college graduation rate. This is an invisible population for most Americans, but it deserves to be investigated and learned about. My coworkers appreciated that I sought to understand more, that I took initiative, and that I admitted when I was wrong, which was often. Had I been complacent about my misunderstandings of Native people, I wouldn't have been offered the chances to learn more. I wouldn't have been able to attend conferences on Indian health, cover congressional hearings held by the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, do research in the National Archives, or alter the course of current legislation on Native education initiatives. I'll leave my internship with a lot of knowledge about legislative affairs in Indian country. But most of all, I'll come away with a strong sense of vulnerability, comfortableness with my inexperience. These things don't have to be limitations on your success, but rather can be used as leverage for your personal progress. Being a good intern, I've learned, isn't about knowing it all, but it's important to remember that just because you're not an expert doesn't mean you're not valuable. Ayehe, thank you.
So in addition to living, learning, and interning here in Washington, while our students are here, we strive to encourage them to serve. Everybody, when they come to Washington, is excited to see the grandeur of Washington, the monuments, the marble halls of the Capitol, and the White House, and everything that everybody recognizes as Washington, D.C. But there's another Washington that other people don't always see, and we try to help our students to see that other Washington and to serve the people here while they're here. So here to talk about service and to represent IPVS, our Institute on Philanthropy and Voluntary Service, is Cynthia Silva. Cynthia attends school at Muhlenberg College. Her hometown is Princeton, New Jersey, and her internship this summer was with Thrive DC. Let's welcome Cynthia.
Good morning, and thank you for the introduction. My name is Cynthia Silva, and I am an incoming sophomore at Muhlenberg College. I'm here today to represent my wonderful program, the Institute of Philanthropy and Voluntary Service, or otherwise known as IPVS. So here's a little bit about me. After high school, I actually took a year off to volunteer with AmeriCorps, committing myself to months working on disaster relief around the country. That experience changed my life, and I decided to commit myself to helping others. On June 4th, I walked into a classroom in Funger Hall to meet the members of IPVS. We were all strangers, but I knew immediately that this was a different group of people. People like me who are passionate about service and creating change. We're people who are active in our communities and campuses and interested in nonprofits. We not only want to come to DC to live, learn, intern, we want to serve. From the beginning, we got started helping the DC community. We replaced internships around the district that focused on mentoring children, alleviating poverty, preventing homelessness, advancing literacy, and many other service-oriented companies and organizations. I was lucky enough to work as a communications intern at Thrive DC, a nonprofit that helps the homeless. That first weekend, we did our first service Saturday, where for 3 hours, we helped clean up the Korean War Memorial, fix up a park, and painted basements to Taylor Swift. It was so much fun, even though it was 98 degrees and we were dying. We went above and beyond when we volunteered with organizations such as Mommies, Bright Beginnings, Mentors Inc., and Martha's Table. From working with kids to handing out groceries to families in need, everyone was enthusiastic and eager to help. In the end, one of the most direct volunteer work we did here were the service projects. You may know or attended one of these events, but what you may have not known is that they were completely led and managed by IPVS members. Such events included the volleyball tournament, cornhole tournament, raffle, kids zone, book sale, and car and doggy wash, which at one point we welcomed a stroller. All proceeds were going to benefit a DC nonprofit, which would be selected by our grant committee. With the help of TFAS, we worked together to be able to provide a $2,000 check to Community Bridges, a nonprofit that has a 100% success rate at helping at-risk female teens get into college. Our site visits were great, too, because we had the chance to explore careers within Peace Corps and the American Red Cross, organizations that are innovators in the nonprofit sector. So what do I take coming out of this? That TFAS is great. A great program, though it was IPVS that gave me the opportunity to see how much power a group of people can make if they share one common goal to serve. I stand here today, about to graduate, and as I look at the people I was honored to serve with, I see people who don't just want to see a better future. They want to be the ones creating it. Thank you.
Next, we'd like to show a slideshow of some of the highlights for the summer. So if everybody on the stage wants to come down, we could go ahead and the students as well. Thank you, Ray, for working so hard on that. I'd like all the students here today to use your imaginations for a minute. Imagine it's the year 2030, 14 years from now. You're seated here in the front row, getting ready to be the commencement speaker at the closing ceremony for the TFAS class of 2030. Can you imagine it? Could it happen? How might it happen? Now let's do the reverse. Let's go backwards. It's the year 2002, 14 years ago. A young man, a student in IBGA, is at his closing ceremony of his TFAS summer. Was he imagining himself speaking before a future TFAS class? If he did so, we might learn that in a minute. Did he imagine it? Did he think how it might happen? What we do know, and what we don't have to imagine, is that his TFAS summer of 2002 began a journey for Mr. Will Weatherford. 4 short years later, after TFAS, he was elected to the Florida House of Representatives at the age of 26. 6 years later, he became the 84th Speaker of the Florida House of Representatives, the youngest Speaker in the United States. As Speaker, Will Weatherford presided over the Florida House as it passed some of the most significant and bold reforms in decades. Will spearheaded an unprecedented joint agenda with the Florida Senate, making historic improvements to Florida's ethics laws, campaign finance laws, and more. He spearheaded education reforms, created the first Florida GI Bill for returning veterans, and expanded school choice options for thousands of parents, all while securing the largest single-year tax cut in decades. In addition to his public service, Will is a businessman, the founder and current managing partner of Weatherford Partners, LLC, a firm specializing in strategic advisory and capital investment services. Will Weatherford grew up in the Tampa area as the second oldest in a family of 9 children and as a graduate of Jacksonville University. He's been recognized for various awards and accolades, including Legislator of the Year by the Florida Bankers Association, Most Valuable Legislator by the Florida Chamber of Commerce, 40 Under 40 People in Politics Outside of Washington, D.C. by the Washington Post. I mentioned earlier that the mission of TFAS is to change the world by developing leaders for a free society. Will Weatherford has brought about change. He is a real change agent. He is a servant leader in every sense of the word. We're so very proud and honored that he could join us today. So let's welcome Mr. Will Weatherford.
Good morning. How's everybody doing? I'm excited to be here. Thank you so much for that amazing introduction. I'm humbled to be here, and I was, as you were mentioning what it must have felt like in 2002 sitting in that seat, I can assure you I wasn't thinking I'd be back up here 14 years later. So it's a huge honor for me and a great opportunity to talk to some just really bright minds. I thoroughly enjoyed listening to the students who spoke before. I want to thank Roger Rehm and the Fund for American Studies. What Roger has done with this organization to bring about this passion for freedom is unprecedented in this country, and his dedication and his board and the entire organization, the staff, they deserve a round of applause. Thank you for what you do, Roger, and for your leadership. I read about some of the speakers that you had a chance to meet with this summer. Folks like Art Laffer, Senators Ron Paul and Mark Warner and Cory Gardner, and Representative Ed Royce and Judge Napolitano, who I saw in one of the photos. And I just kind of want to apologize on the outset that I'm sorry you have to finish on such a low note. But I do also want to, I would like to introduce you to my daughter. I brought with me my 8-year-old daughter, Ella. We have 4 children, my wife and I. We have an 8-year-old, a 5-year-old, a 3-year-old, and a 1-year-old. And Ella's 8. She got to come with me, and we're spending a few days in Washington so she can get her first experience of this amazing city. And so, Ella, thank you for being here with me and for being participating in tonight's. Funny story about Ella. 3 years ago, I'm the Speaker of the House. I'm taking her to her kindergarten class, and she's sitting next to me, and she says, "Daddy, I'm a little bit confused about something." I said, "Okay, honey, well, what are you confused about?" She said, "Well, you're the Speaker of the House, right?" I said, "Yeah, that's right." She said, "What does that mean?" I said, "Well, you're kind of in charge. You know, it's your job to set the tone and the agenda and make a lot of big decisions and empower people." And she said, "Okay, well, I mean, that's what's so confusing. If you're the Speaker of the House in Tallahassee, how come Mom's the Speaker of our house?" So she was a very perceptive 5-year-old. She's a really perceptive 8-year-old, I can assure you. But I've said many times, and I'll say it again, the Fund for American Studies changed the trajectory of my life. When I came here in the summer of 2002 and what I thought I wanted to do with my life going forward, it was altered. It was changed. It was changed in a very positive way. Another reason that I love the Fund for American Studies is not just because of the impact it's had on me, but because we share a passion. They feel called to espouse the values of free enterprise and the critical importance of individual freedom in our society. It should be noted that they don't do this to promote an ideology. The fund promotes free enterprise because they know it is the catalyst for economic prosperity, for human flourishing, and for freedom. They know that it's brought human dignity to billions of people around the world who've been blessed to experience it and have risen out of poverty because of it. So to the students who are now alumni of the Fund for American Studies, I might add, this summer's gone by pretty quick, hasn't it? You look at those pictures, and you probably didn't think that this date would be here as quickly as it did. I remember my summer flew by, but what an amazing experience you've had. Most of you, if not all of you, have developed really strong relationships with people that are sitting right beside you that will last a lifetime. I can tell you I know of 8 people that were part of my class that I still to this day communicate with on a regular basis. You will have that wonderful bond with these people as well. Now, they say confession is good for the soul, so I have a little bit of a confession to make. I don't remember a single word that was said at my TFAS closing ceremony. You know what's embarrassing about that? I spoke at my TFAS closing ceremony, and I actually introduced the keynote speaker, who was Dinesh D'Souza at that year. So I just say that because I have no preconceived notions or unrealistic expectations that you're going to be hanging on every word that I say, nor even remembering it 14 years from now. But thank you for indulging me. However, I do have a few things that I'd like to share with you this morning that I hope will be of some encouragement to you. But before I do that, let me give you a quick overview of how I was so blessed to leave Washington, D.C. in the summer of 2002, and only 4 short years later, be able to run and win and serve as a member of the Florida House of Representatives. It's an important story, but it starts with a really interesting, scary moment. 2 years later, after I left here, I took a job with a gentleman who was a legislator, and he was going to be the Speaker of the House in Florida. And on my very first day on the job, we were going to a fundraiser in a small town in Florida called Pensacola. We were flying on a plane, and it was a really small prop plane. My first time ever flying on a private plane. And we're in the air, and we're on our way back, and it was about a 20-minute flight, very, very short. And about 8 minutes into the flight, a small little problem occurred. There was a fire in the cockpit. As you know, fires in the cockpit are usually a bad thing when it's associated with a plane. And we managed to, over the next 30 seconds, have the cabin fill up with smoke, lose control of the plane, go upside down, and start to free fall. Now, we were only about 5,500 feet in the air, and we fell over 4,000 feet, and we were seconds within impact of the Gulf of Mexico. Luckily, we had a very experienced pilot, and the pilot was able to pull us up and essentially save our lives through an emergency landing. I was 24 years old. I was an ambitious young man, but I really didn't know how quickly I should move on to the next phase of my life. But after that night, I knew the Lord had given me a second chance, and I kissed the ground when we got off that plane. And I couldn't sleep that night. I was restless. And I remember saying to myself, I am never, ever going to be in a position where I feel like the rest of any part of my life going forward is going to be a waste. It is going to be meaningful because every day is a blessing. And I felt like I was given a second chance at life. And so 2 years later after that, I was elected to the Florida House. But let me tell you about that story because this is another unique one as well. I get a call 7 weeks from Election Day in 2006, and the call goes something like this. Will, tomorrow Governor Bush is appointing Ken Littlefield, your state representative, to the Public Service Commission, and we need to find a replacement to run in his stead. I was 26 years old. I had no experience. I knew I wanted to run for office. I was waiting for an opportunity, but this just came out of nowhere. So I said, great. How long do I have to make a decision? 24 hours. By the way, this conversation was with a person by the name of Senator Marco Rubio, you may have heard of, who was the Speaker of the House of Florida at that time. So I had 24 hours to make a decision, and of course, I knew that night it was something I wanted to do. I felt called to do it. I felt God had opened up this door for me to do it. But the interesting part about it was the ballots had already been printed in Florida. And we had this weird law that said, if that happens, and I was the first person with this new law for it to happen, you have to actually run under the name of the person who was already on the ballot. So the ballots had been printed, and here I am. I'm this 26-year-old kid. I don't know anything about politics aside from a little limited experience I'd had. Most of it in Washington, D.C., and I was running under someone else's name. To make it even more bizarre, about a month into the campaign, my opponent was sadly arrested and put into a mental institution where he stayed until Election Day. Here's where it gets crazy. He's living in a mental institution. It's widely covered by every newspaper multiple times. I mean, it's the biggest story in my small community. And on Election Day, he still got 42% of the vote. If that doesn't show you that partisanship still lives in America, I don't know what else does. Either that or that says something really scary about me. But either way, that is how. Those are the unique and crazy circumstances under which I came into the Florida legislature. It was unique, and it was crazy, but it was an amazing experience and an opportunity to give back in a way that I never thought possible. And speaking of politics, just for a moment, I want to mention the current political mass that is facing our country, the division, the anger, the partisanship. It seems like if you don't hate and belittle the other party or your other candidate, then no one wants to hear what you have to say. It's as if politics through insult is the new norm. As a Republican, I can tell you, I never went into public service because I didn't like Democrats. I went into public service because I loved America and I loved Florida. But it's also important to remember that politics is a direct reflection of the culture of the people of whom it represents. We only need to look into the mirror to understand why we are in the state that we are as a nation. The good news is, it doesn't have to be that way. The famous French diplomat to America, Alex de Tocqueville, said that the greatest of America lies not in being more enlightened than any other nation, but rather in her ability to repair her faults. I'm hopeful that Mr. de Tocqueville is right, and we can do so here again. What's unique and complicated about the 21st century political system is the overwhelming access to information. And of course, a lot of that is misinformation. According to Pew Research, over 62% of Americans get some or all of their news from Facebook. They also believe that news to be completely unbiased. Of course, as you probably know, or maybe you don't know, Facebook uses algorithms that essentially keep feeding you based on your past behavior and what they think you want to see, and therefore reinforcing what you already believe. Now you add that to a 24-hour partisan news cycle and a blogosphere that never stops, and you get the picture. People's views and beliefs are not being challenged anymore. They're just being reinforced. And it's as if two people living in a neighborhood with homes next door to each other believe they're living in different Americas because based on the information they receive every day, they are. This is a very confusing time for the American people. For some of you, this November may be the first time that you ever get to vote in a presidential election. Talk about bad timing. Just kidding. Sort of. In all seriousness, the state of the political discourse in this country is at a very low point, and no one would argue with that. But I want each and every one of you to know something. It does not have to be that way. This is not normal, and our country deserves better, and I hope you will participate in repairing the political discourse of America. As I said earlier, I was blessed at a very young age to be able to serve and lead men and women in my great state. I learned during that time, and I'd like to share with you for my last few moments here, a few things that I think have helped me in my short political and professional career. The first, and it's obvious, but it's important to know, is to never, ever, ever give up. You are going to be faced with some type of challenge, some circumstance that you could have never predicted that is going to try to take you off course of where you're going. Do not give up. When I was 22 years old, I graduated from college. It was a year after I left the fund, and I couldn't find a job. It was after September 11th. I was living in Jacksonville, Florida at the time. All my friends had landed jobs, and in this embarrassing moment, I'm leaving. I was the student body president of my school. I was the captain of my football team, and I could not find a decent job. So for the next 5 months, I worked at a place called Lakeshore Radiator, where I put radiators on pallets and put them in the back of buses for 10 bucks an hour. And it was embarrassing. It was humiliating. It was hot. It wasn't a lot of fun. And I remember in that moment just thinking to myself, gosh, how did this happen? I mean, I was in Washington, D.C. last summer. I had it figured out. I was a student body president. Life is supposed to be easier than this. I thought I put the work in. But when I look back, those 4 months were probably the most important and impactful 4 months of my life because it taught me humility. And it reminded me that both my faith and my Creator and my faith in myself was being tested. And I had to fight through it. You will have to fight through it. Don't ever, ever give up. Number two, do not live a life in fear. Now, there's a difference between being fearful and being scared. Now, when I was on that plane and we were flying down and losing altitude rapidly, I was scared to death. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm proud to admit it. But fear is a paralyzing thing. In the Bible, over 350 times it uses phrases like, do not be afraid, do not fear, do not be anxious. And I believe there's a reason for that. Maybe God had a point there he was trying to make. Psychologists will tell you that fear is one of the most powerful human emotions that we can have. Fear is what is crippling this city right here in Washington, D.C. Fear is what prevents entrepreneurs from taking risk. It's what prevents political officials from doing the right and just thing and prevents them from finding middle ground out of fear of the extremes of their respective parties. Fear will kill you physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Do not live a life of fear. You have nothing to fear. I took my daughter last night for her first time to see some monuments, and we were there at FDR's famous monument, and I was staring at the wall and said, there's nothing to fear but fear itself. And I said, Ella, remember that. We do not have to live a life of fear. Number three, give back by serving others regardless of where your professional career takes you. Winston Churchill in 1943 gave a speech that is now famous. He was at Harvard, it was at a commencement ceremony, and it was in the middle of World War II. And he knew that at the end of World War II, there was going to be a changing of the guard with regard to who the global dominant force in the world was going to be. And it was transferring from Great Britain to the United States of America. And he knew it. And he took the opportunity in this speech that has been kind of deemed the speech, which is called The Price of Greatness is Responsibility. And his point that he was trying to make in this speech is that America had become a great nation, but there's a responsibility as people that come with that greatness. You see, the greatness of America is not endowed by our Creator, nor is it guaranteed. Each generation in America has a responsibility to earn and achieve that greatness. You see, it's the idea of America that's exceptional. But collectively, we have to live up to that idea. Because what is embedded in that idea is that we are a people who serve each other and those around us who are in the greatest need. That's what makes us great. Of course, you can serve in many ways. You can mentor a young person. You can serve in a soup kitchen. You can help someone in their time of need through small acts of kindness. You can run for office. But I want to point out the fact that there are many people that think to be a public servant, you have to put your name on a ballot. You have to run for office to serve. That is not true. Some of the greatest public servants I've ever met in my entire life never ran for public office, never put their name on a ballot. So don't feel like, I hope some of you do run for office, but don't feel like the only way for you to contribute and to make a difference in this world is by doing so. It's far from the truth. You can serve regardless of what you're doing, but whatever you do, make sure you serve. Lastly, number four, do not wait to go after your dreams. Do not wait. When I was 26 and I got that call about the opportunity to run for office, a lot of people told me not to do it. They said I was too young, I wasn't ready, and that I shouldn't do it. And I just thought and I prayed about it and I thought, you know, I feel in my gut it's the right thing to do and I don't see why I have to wait. What am I waiting for? When I got into office in Florida with term limits, you essentially have to start running for Speaker of the House almost immediately. And I had a lot of people that said, look, nobody's gonna vote for a Speaker of the House. The average age up there is probably 60, 55 or 60. They're not gonna vote for a 26-year-old to be the Speaker of the House. It's just not gonna happen. You're wasting your time. But I felt like, what am I waiting for? If I feel like I have something to offer my state and my community, why would I wait and allow someone else to do it if I feel like I have something to contribute? And so I didn't. And I don't say this to brag about my accomplishments. I say it because you don't have to wait your turn. You don't have to ask for permission. You don't have to be conventional. And you don't have to wait to go after your dreams. Sometimes in life, you just have to go for it. Sometimes you have to stand tall and be willing to risk it all. In 1519, there was a Spanish explorer and conquistador named Hernando Cortez. Hernando Cortez had an interesting story. He was trying to essentially invade what is now modern-day Mexico, but was ruled by the Aztec army for over 600 years. He had 500 soldiers and 100 sailors, and he landed 11 ships on the shores of the Yucatan. Despite this large army that he was facing, he was intent on invading this army that had much larger numbers than his. Some estimate it was 50 to 1. And so as he's on the beaches of the Yucatan, and he's trying to decide how he's going to motivate his men to go into battle, he gave a speech that was so short it would make Abraham Lincoln blush. He said three words: burn the ships. Everybody looked around and said, what does he mean, burn the ships? Burn the ships. Either we will die here today, or we will be victorious. There is no going home. There is no going back. And sometimes in life, you just have to burn the ships. You have to be prepared to go all the way to achieve what you know God has called you to do in your life. So, never give up. Do not live a life in fear. Give back by serving others. And don't wait to go after your dreams, but be willing to burn the ships. I am grateful for this opportunity today. I am proud of each and every one of you, and I welcome you to the family of the Fund for American Studies. Thank you.
Well, that was very inspiring. Thank you so much, Will. And as a token of appreciation, I want to give you the official Fund for American Studies tie here.
Oh, wow, yeah.
So, thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Great.
I don't need these because I can't see you anyway. It's complete blackness out there. Well, I tell you, I want to say a few things in closing. I've been inspired very much by Will Weatherford's remarks, by the remarks of all the students, and also by Joe Starr's introduction of Will Weatherford, because it spoke to me very personally. I attended a fund program in 1976, and after about 15 years in other jobs, I came back to the fund as a member of the staff. And I've been there now for 25 years. It's hard to imagine that this is the 25th summer of standing before students and sending them off. And I was thinking that 25 years from now, I'm not going to be around. I'll be watching each of you from behind the veil, I hope, and seeing what kind of world you're creating, what kind of world that my generation has passed along that you're able to be agents of change in, and hopefully making it a better place. I have every confidence that things are getting better in the world. And you look around and you see it. You're going to be living much richer lives with more material prosperity than we have today. That has been the trend for hundreds of years, for more than 200 years. I was in St. Louis with our Executive Vice President, Steve Slattery, earlier this week at a program, and our speaker there was fascinating, and he made a very controversial point, but I'm going to share it with you, and you may not agree with it, but he said, if you want to know what your life will be like in 30 years, or the life of the average American will be like in 30 or 40 years, go to the wealthiest neighborhoods in your city and look at how people are living, and that is how everyone will be living in 30 or 40 years. Very controversial after dinner topic, but he then showed that that has been the course of history. In 1900, only the richest had automobiles. 30, 40 years later, everyone had automobiles. In 1960, only the richest had color TVs. 30 or 40 years later, everyone had not just color TVs, but much better TVs. You see it with medicine, healthcare in this country. The cell phone, 1980, thousands of dollars to have this brick that you could hold to your ear and talk to someone for a very expensive price. Today we get cell phones for virtually nothing, and almost every American has one. And that progress could continue if we have the right ideas and the right institutions in our society, if we give every American opportunities for human flourishing. And I hope this summer, I know most of you took economics, that it helped you develop an economic way of thinking and think about the world and the opportunity in the world and the way it works. Many of you took courses in leadership and ethics and American government and foreign policy. I hope all these courses together have better prepared you to be better leaders, to be better friends, better family members, to help make this world a better place. Today you'll be joining the TFAS Alumni Network. It's a network that literally spans the globe. Through our programs in Hong Kong, Prague, Santiago, Chile, program we used to have in Greece, we have alumni throughout this world that you're going to be part of a network with in the future. Our alumni serve in Congress. They're members of the House and the Senate who are alums of TFAS. State legislators, like Will Weatherford was, throughout the country who are TFAS alumni, others who work on congressional staffs. We have alumni anchoring the network news, covering presidential campaigns. Alumni who are doing remarkable things, serving in the U.S. Armed Forces. They're leaders in business, government, journalism, public policy, education. And now you're going to become part of that alumni network. We have alums serving as judges. Last night we had an alum who's a justice of the Arizona Supreme Court speak to our law students. We have an alum clerking for U.S. Supreme Court justice. And alums who are in the courtroom every day, serving as appearing for clients before the court. We have alums serving as college presidents, provosts, and college professors. Our TFAS alumni have won Rhodes Scholarships, Pulitzer Prizes, Fulbrights, and other important awards and honors. And as I said, alumni around the world are fighting for democracy, individual freedom, human rights, the rule of law, from Venezuela to Vietnam and Cuba to Cambodia. And now you're part of that network. So please keep in touch with us in the future as you go forward. Tell us what you're doing. Come visit us when you're in Washington. Reconnect with us at all times along the way, and we'll put you in touch with alumni who can help you advance in your careers. It's been great this summer to follow your activities. Mally Woodfin's been great at keeping us connected to you through the tweets you send out. Megan, who spoke, was very active. I saw all her tweets, I think, and a lot of the rest of you. You had, I think, a wonderful summer in terms of the things you tweeted about, seeing presidential motorcades traveling around the city. Some of you, I think, saw Marine One landing on the grounds of the White House. You went to many Nats games. You learned to navigate a broken down DC metro system. You were covering events in town. I saw things that you were writing, covering everyone from Secretary of State John Kerry to House Speaker Paul Ryan and lots in between. You got to visit Mount Vernon and lots of other monuments, museums, and historic landmarks. You enjoyed an unfortunately damp 4th of July fireworks display that was marvelous. I've also read about many of these tweets that commented on the new friendships that have been developed, tweets with tags that say best friends forever. And I want to emphasize what Will Weatherford said. I too continue to keep in touch with friends from 40 some years ago or 35 years ago when I came through the program. So keep those friendships going. We love that TFAS community to stay close together because you can be good friends from this shared experience. Well, the world is waiting for your leadership. It desperately needs your leadership. So don't let us down. Be honorable leaders. Go out with a questioning spirit, a sense of skepticism about the things you hear. Search for the truth. Search for what's right and just. And do all you can to make the world a better place. Congratulations. You've lived, learned, and interned, and we look forward to a lifetime together.